Incredibly glad you joined us here today at Church on the Rock. If this is your first time, let me encourage you to go to jesusoftherock.org. Then you can check out our latest blog post, you can look at our latest podcast, or you can give to our ministries financially by clicking on the giving button at the top right-hand corner of the screen. Now, as you go through this message, I pray that God works life change into your life, and welcome to Church on the Rock.
Identity crisis. And I think many of us fall prey to have an identity crisis. We're going to talk a little bit about that this morning. Romans chapter 12, verse 1, Paul writes, it says, "So, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he's done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him." Pay attention to verse 2. He says, "Don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think." Say that with me. Changing the way you think. "Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." Now, if you're used to the King James Version, it's maybe more familiar to you. It says, "Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind." But that's just a King James way of saying changing the way you think. But it says, "But letting God change the way you think." According to dictionary.com, if you ever use dictionary.com, I didn't even know they had a word of the year, but obviously they do. And the word of the year for 2015 for dictionary.com was identity. Identity. Why do you suppose that was? I'm not sure, but I want to throw a couple of ideas out there to you. A couple of possibilities. One may be because of a lady named Rachel Dolezal. She was in the news a lot in 2015. If you remember, Rachel was born the daughter of two Caucasian parents, but she identified herself as African American. And it made headlines all across the country. Or there was Bruce Jenner, who was born in a male body, but he identified himself as a female. And as strange as it sounds, he was the runner-up for Time Magazine's Person of the Year in 2015. Also in 2015, the city of Houston, Texas actually held a vote to determine which restroom facility a person should use if they have the body of one gender but identify his or herself as the opposite gender. And this actually came to a vote in the city of Houston, Texas. So identity was a big deal in 2015. I personally think identity is still a big deal. I think that there may not be a more important word than identity. Really, identity, understand the first thing about identity. Identity is different than identification. Identification, a police officer may walk up to your window and say, "Let me see some identification." Or if you go to buy cigarettes or alcohol or Sudafed or something, a clerk may say, "Can I see some identification?" Identification is how other people identify you. Identity is how you identify yourself. That's the main, so keep that in mind. When we talk about identity, we're talking about how we see ourselves. How do we identify ourselves? Now, want to look first of all this morning, what forms our identity? What creates our identity, our self-image, how we see ourselves? What makes up that identity? Well, some things are right off the bat at birth. The moment that we're born, it comes out what? It's a boy. It's a girl. So part of our identity starts being created and formed right there. And the next thing we say is he's got, you know, his daddy's eyes or his mama's nose or this, that, the other. And so our identity starts being created very, very early. And then the family that we're born into, the environment you were raised in, the schools you attended, the friends you hung out with. I say all the time, I tell our young people, show me your friends, I'll show you your future. The people that we hung out with, the people you dated, the music you listened to, the church you attended or didn't attend, all of these things help to shape your identity. They help to tell you today who you are. When you look at yourself today, all of that past, all of our history, all of those things help to shape who you see yourself as today. Another thing that helps to shape our identity is events. Events, because we all have events that happen in our life. What kind of events? I could give you 100, but let me just throw some out to kind of tell you things I'm thinking about. A pregnancy, that's a big event in your life. A job, the loss of a job. The loss of a loved one. A diagnosis of cancer. Right? Suddenly our identity's changed. He's terminal. She's terminal. There's something, a car accident, the birth of a child, a marriage, a divorce, all of these things, a criminal conviction, a lawsuit. These things change our identity. They change the way we look at ourselves. And our identity is ever changing as events change. Our identity is a process. It's not a one-time thing. It continues to unfold. Our identities are always a work in progress. In other words, I probably don't see myself today like I saw myself 20 years ago, right? I see a little more of myself today than I did 20 years ago. But our identities change. Now, are these events, are they good or are they bad? To be honest, yeah, they're both and they're neither. Events are not good or bad. Events are neutral. They're just things that happen. It's how we process them and what effect we allow them to have on us that truly determines how they affect our identity. Events are just events. The question, the better question is, how have these events affected us? Now you can, I want to just take 1 minute and just kind of play with this and push the envelope. And this is, you know, just my crazy way of thinking. But tell me, you know, what do you think about when I say words like a house fire or crime or terrorists or, you know, war or auto accidents or sickness and disease or sin? These are all words. And when we hear them, they kind of have a negative connotation to them, don't they? I mean, none of these things sound good. And yet, just to play with the thought for a minute, think about this. If there were no house fires, how many firemen would be out of work? If there were no crime, we'd have unemployed police officers everywhere. If there were no terrorists and war, how many soldiers would be looking for work? And not to mention shipyard workers and people who build military aircraft and all of these things, there would be no jobs for them because there'd be no war. There would be no need for that. If there were no sickness and no disease, how many hospitals and doctor's offices and nurses and pharmacists and all of these things, everything in the medical profession would be out of work. If there were no sin, pastors wouldn't have much to preach about. In fact, I started thinking, when I get to heaven, I got to find a new career. Yeah, seriously, I don't know. I gotta start looking for something else to do. Chuck Colson said, life is about 10% what happens to you and about 90% how you respond to it. Life happens. Events happen. How do we deal with them? How do we respond to them? And the way we respond to them really does help shape the way we identify ourselves or we define ourselves. How many remember the old Johnny Cash song called A Boy Named Sue? You remember that? Daddy was getting ready. He was leaving his family behind, so he had this baby, and he named him Sue. And this boy grew up hating this name, and he went on. He was going to find his daddy, and he was going to kill him for giving him that name. And he found him, and they fought, and he was ready to kill his daddy, and his daddy said, you deserve it. Go ahead and kill me, but before you do, you ought to thank me for giving you that name. Because I was leaving, and I knew you were going to have to get tough. So I gave you that name, you know, and so he got tough and all that. So, you know, it's a negative thing, but he says you are who you are because of that name. Because I gave you that. It took a negative event and used it for something positive. If you could think about one event in your life that's maybe had a huge impact on you, for better or for worse, there's an event that you think about, what would it be? For me, it may be in 1986, God called me to preach. And that had a huge impact on my life. It's had a profound effect on the direction of my life. Both marriage and divorce has had a profound effect on my life. But what really makes these things so profound is what I believe about them, how I respond to them, how I've allowed these events to shape and reshape my life over and over again. These things happen. You too have had events in your life that have literally changed the course of your life. They changed the direction of your life. You think about things where we come to a fork in the road and we think, what if I had married him instead of him? What if I had taken that job? What if I had went to college? Or if I hadn't, you know, these things. And our lives would be set on a completely different direction. But what's really changed is not so much the event, but how we responded to the event and what you believe about the event. Now this, you say, "What? All right, but is all this really important?" I said last Sunday, you know, we got heaven and hell stuff to talk about. Is this really important? I think it is. I think it's critical, and I'll tell you why. This is why I think this message particularly is so important, is because all of these events, all of these things, all of our identity, it's what brings us to a pivotal point in our life. I think today, this message, today may be a very pivotal moment in your life because you understand that the events that has happened in your life up until today, what you believe about them has given you the identity that you have today. And some of you may be sitting here with a very skewed, very distorted identity of yourself. You may have a really bad definition of you. You may have an overinflated ego and think you're something you're not. The Bible says be careful that you don't think more highly of yourself than you should. Or you may be in the other direction and you've got a really, really bad definition of yourself. And whatever that is, it's skewed, you know, that it's not right. And so all that's happened in our past brings us to today and hopefully, when we reach that pivotal point of today, it's going to affect not only today, but it's going to affect our future. It's going to affect the decisions that we make in the future. So I think it's a very, very important message. Now, sometimes we feel like this pivotal point is Christianity or our choice to become a Christ follower. And that certainly can affect it. Make no mistake about it. But it doesn't always determine it. See, we'll quote scriptures like, old things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new, and we're new creatures in Christ. And all that is great, and it's true. But how many know even new creatures have bad days? Even new creatures have old habits that will try to creep back in on us. You know? And that's why it's not done with a decision. Or an experience. It's great. It all may start there, but to change from your past to your future is always going to be a process. That's why Paul writes, and he says, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. That's not a one-time deal. That's a process of changing the way you think. We're ever evolving in the way that we think. So I want to spend just a couple more minutes talking about this process of renewing our mind and changing the way we process the events that happen in our lives. And hopefully, my prayer is that the end result of the message today will be that our futures will be better than and more productive than our past. If we can do that, I'll be happy. If we leave here and our futures are better and more productive than our past, then I'll be done my job. That's what we're shooting for. So how do you process the events in your life? Let's look at a really basic one, one that will affect every one of us. I'm just going to go ahead and include everybody in this one. This is one event that will happen to each and every one of us to some degree. That event is age. Every one of us. If you're here, age has already affected you to some point. I don't care if you're 2 weeks old, you got 2 weeks behind you. Age affects all of us. But as we grow older, particularly after 40, 50, 60, Gary, you want me to talk about your birthday? Gary's birthday is today. He hits a big 5-0. Yeah, we went and celebrated yesterday. AARP will be calling his number and sending him mail. I've got a collection of AARP stuff. Something happens when we hit that midlife thing. Some people call it a midlife crisis, but something happens and we start to have these thoughts like we're running out of time. Now, some teenagers are saying, yeah, wait, it's coming. When you hit and you begin to realize, wait a minute, you know, whether it's a midpoint or what, I'm starting to run out of time. Maybe we start thinking my best days are behind me. And sometimes we even start feeling like there's, you know, a feeling of uselessness. You know, I used to could do this and I used, but because of this thing called age, we start having regrets about our past and even worse, a sense of hopelessness about our future. Am I really going to be able to do this? Am I going to have a retirement? Am I going to be able to do this? You know, I'm not always going to be able to work and support my family. But what would happen if we just refuse to conform to the pattern of this world, like Paul talks about, and like he instructed us, what would happen if we refuse to copy the behavior and customs of this world and begin to allow God to renew our minds or our ways of thinking? And instead of seeing that event of age, that pivotal point, to lead us into a future of despair and depression and crisis, instead, what if we renewed our mind and realized that just by our age, we possess something that only age can bring? Experience. Experience. Age is the only thing that can bring experience. And with that, hopefully comes some wisdom. Even if your past is full of mistakes, even if it's a horrible past and many regrets, you can still be beneficial to the future of yourself and to others. I've said this for the last couple of weeks. Even everybody has a purpose, even if your purpose is to be a bad example. If you live this horrible life and young people can look and say, that's what I don't want to do. That's what I don't need. In fact, God uses wounded soldiers. God uses people that's done things the wrong way and has made horrible mistakes. God said, I can use you like I cannot use other people. I can't tell you when you're going through, you know, crack cocaine addiction. I know what you're going through. I have no idea, but there's some folks in the room that can. They can say, let me tell you what this does. Let me tell you where this road leads to. God loves wounded soldiers. So your past, so the poor choices of your past may determine the good choices of someone else's future because of age, because of experience. So suddenly age is not a bad thing. Age is a great thing. You may be more useful to the kingdom of God now than you've ever been before just by experience. All right, so let's try to wrap this thing up. The most important aspect of identifying or defining your true identity is discovering what is true about you. Because this is where we get messed up. We start thinking things about us that aren't true. So we really have to define what's true about you. What's true about you? Sometimes we allow our past to tell us what's true about us, don't we? We allow that to define us, what's true about us. Sometimes we allow others to tell us what's true about us. Sometimes we allow our imaginations to tell us what's true about us. Sometimes we allow these events in our life to tell us what's true about us. Think real quickly of one thing that you know is true about you. One thing that you know is true about you. And if you truly know that one thing is really true about you, then that one thing has helped to give you your identity that you have today. How you see yourself today. You realize that. Whatever that one thing is that you know this is true, that's helped you to at least think that's who you are today. That's how you see yourself. That's how you identify yourself. Now, the truth is there are many things that are true about you. Many things. Some of them you're aware of, some of them you may not be aware of. So knowing that, ranking truth becomes pretty important, which brings me to the most important thing I'm going to tell you this morning. And that is the absolute most important truth about you is not what others say about you. The most important truth about you is not what your past says about you. That's a lie from the pits of hell. The most important truth about you is not what your imagination says it is. But the absolute number one most important truth about you is what your Heavenly Father says about you. He is God, and the Word says He cannot lie. What your Creator says about you is the most important truth. Now, there are other things that may be true about you, but that is the most important truth about you. Listen to me, teenager, particularly teenage girls. If a 15-year-old boy tells you that you are the most beautiful girl in the world, do not believe it. Because that 15-year-old boy told you that. Now, because that 15-year-old boy is going to tell a lot more girls that same thing a lot of times. So don't believe. Now, listen to me. You are beautiful, but not because little Justin Bieber told you that. Okay? You are beautiful because your Father, your Creator, told you that. He said, "You are beautiful. You are my masterpiece. You're created in the image and likeness of me." That's why you are beautiful. Our identity, that pivotal point in our life, is understanding and learning what God says is true about me. That's the most important thing. Have you ever tried to make yourself not think? Am I the only one who does that? You know, just you're trying to go to sleep and you say, "Stop thinking. Just stop thinking." I don't do the counting sheep and all that. I'm just like, just go black. Just go into a dark, you stop thinking. And then in 10 seconds, you're thinking again. You're thinking about how to not think. And you know, I mean, it's like, it's impossible. You can't stop thinking. And so I love this. The Scripture doesn't tell us to stop thinking. Sometimes it would be nice, but it doesn't. What it does tell us we can do is we can start thinking the right way. It says that let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. You can start replacing those old thoughts with new thoughts, with true thoughts. Those lies that the enemy's placed there or your imagination's placed there. And remember, this doesn't come by a zap. But this comes in a process. You start replacing those negative thoughts with positive thoughts. Listen to this statement. If you miss everything else I said today, don't miss this. Stop trying to find your identity in what you do and start bringing your true identity into everything you do. Into everything you do, you go into it knowing your true identity, knowing if you don't know anything else, this is what my Father says about me. This is what my Creator says about me. This is not what other people say. This is not what I think. It's not what my past thinks. Last question. What does my Father say about me? What does my Creator say is most true about me? What does He say is most true about you? He says you belong to Him. That ought to be enough to make some of us happy. He says you belong to Him. He says you are His masterpiece. He says, "I chose you." He says, "I have a plan for you." a plan for good and not of evil, that you may have a hope and a future. He says you are a new creation in him. He says that you are secure in him, that you are complete in him. He says that I love you just like you are, not even as you should be. I love you just like you are. I can never love you more than I do right now, and I'll never love you less than I do right now. That's what your Father says about you. You're dearly loved. He says that you cannot ever be separated from his love. That's what your Father says about you. And he says you've been invited to partake in everything that he has for you. That's what your Father says about you. That's what your Creator says about you. It's like a little baby that is trying to walk. You know, they're trying to pull up on the couch. And how do you tell them to do something they've never done before? They don't have that experience of walking. And, you know, you keep trying to tell them, here, you can do it. You can do it. You know when they do it? When they finally believe what their daddy's been telling them. When they finally believe, when they step out and they take that and say, you know, I don't have to crawl the rest of my life. I can walk. I can walk because my Father says I can walk. He says I can do it. And I'm telling you, the thing that is most true about you is what God says is true about you. And I hope today is that pivotal point in your life when you begin to seriously evaluate your identity and how you define yourself. Stop defining yourself by your past. Stop defining yourself by what others say about you. Well, he's an alcoholic. She's a drug addict. They're a convict. He's a homosexual. He's a thief. He's a drug. He's this. She's that. What other people are saying, stop it and begin to identify yourself by what your Father says. I am loved by God. I am chosen by God. I am accepted by God. He is my Father. And when he looks at me, he looks through the lens of the blood of his Son, Jesus Christ, and sees me as redeemed. He said, I'm an overcomer. He said that I'm a more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. That's who I am. He said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Don't tell me what I can't do. Let me tell you what my Father said I can do. And if he said I can do it, that's what's most true about me. I may struggle. I may fall down. I may skin my knees. I may hurt my elbow, but I can get up. My Father said, if I fall 1,000 times, I can get up. And I can be what he wants me to be. And I hope that today is that pivotal point for some of you. You may have come in here thinking with a wrong identity about yourself. You may have come in here thinking what people had said about you was true, what you've thought about yourself, what your past has told you. But today, you start a new journey. It's not a holy zap. It's not something, but today can begin. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world. Let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and perfect and pleasing. Amen? Amen. Amen. Stand to your feet.
Again, we are so incredibly glad you joined us here today at Church on the Rock. Now, if this message encouraged you in any way, let me encourage you to go to JesusOfTheRock.org and let us know about it. Those type of messages encourage us as we work throughout the week. While you're there, check out our latest podcast or give to our ministries financially by clicking on the giving button at the top right-hand corner of the screen. Again, thank you for joining us today and have a blessed week.